Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Diamonds and Daggers by Nancy Warren, narrated by Sarah Zimmerman. Chapter 1. Lucy, I have decided to make you the beneficiary of my estate, Sylvia Strand announced with drama. Of course, having been a famous stage and screen actress in the silent era, Sylvia was always big on drama. She had come to visit me in my Oxford flat above Cardinal Woolsey's knitting and yarn shop, and she was alone, which was odd. Normally, she and Agnes Bartlett, my grandmother, were inseparable. She looked at me expectantly, but I wasn't sure how to react. Sylvia was a vampire, so chances were that I, a mere mortal, was going to be pushing up daisies for centuries while she was still enjoying her wealth. I sensed there was more going on here than a desire to put her affairs in order. However, I didn't want to appear rude, so I said, "Thank you." There was a pause. She seemed to expect more. "I'm worth a great deal, you know. My jewels alone are worth a small fortune." Her lips curved in a smile. "Perhaps not so small." I really didn't want to play games with Sylvia. She always won. So I said, "Unless there's something I don't know, you'll be wearing your jewels long after I'm gone." "One never knows," she said vaguely. And then suddenly dropped the attitude and sat on one of the chintz chairs in my living room, inviting me to sit opposite her on the couch. "Oh, all right. I need your help." Nix came in the window, sniffed at Sylvia's ankles, and jumped onto my lap. I was happy to have my familiar close while the glamorous vampire explained whatever favor she wanted. "It's quite simple, really. A film company is remaking The Professor's Wife, one of my most famous films." I knew this, and she'd been furious when she found out. Now she seemed to have changed her tune. "Okay," I said cautiously. "The company contacted my estate's lawyer, Bertram Winthrop." "Her estate's lawyer? Is he undead? Oh yes, I never do business with daywalkers, too temporary." "Right. Bertram tells me Rune Films wants to pay homage to the original. They intend to recreate the set of jewels used in the film." "What jewels?" She chuckled softly. "Cartier designed a unique set for me to wear in the movie, and in the terms of my contract, I was able to keep them." "Cartier designed jewelry especially for you?" "Of course, Jacques was a good friend. I was paid in those jewels. The diamonds were flawless, the emeralds remarkable in color, and the design is pure deco." "Wow, that was quite the paycheck." "I've kept them, always. Now I want you to wear them." Suddenly I felt like there wasn't enough air in the room. "You want me to wear a priceless set of diamonds and emeralds?" "Where?" "Here in Oxford. First, you're to meet with the producers in London as my beneficiary, representing my estate." "London?" "That's right. You'll sign the contract giving the company the right to reproduce the jewels for the film and to have the real ones on display for a gala evening to announce the film. You will wear the jewels at this party. It will be held at St. Peter's College where the film is being shot. It's very exciting for you." I didn't feel the least bit excited. In fact, I felt faint. "Are the jewels insured?" "How does one insure that which is priceless?" She let that hang in the air for a moment and then leaned forward. "Don't lose them." The Vampire Knitting Club met that night, but Sylvia had sworn me to secrecy. The vampire knitters might be the closest she had to friends, but I could tell she didn't trust them, at least not with her priceless collection of jewels. Gran wasn't on the secret, though. She looked delighted when she came upstairs through the trap door from the subterranean apartments that some of them shared below my shop. She said, "Lucy, isn't it exciting? You're going to be a film star." I nearly choked, but Sylvia made it sound like she genuinely was choking. "A film star. She'll be wearing my jewels, a stunning collection that once did belong to a film star back when people understood what glamour really was." I had to hide my smile as she struck a pose like Greta Garbo in an old black-and-white movie. Gran hastily covered over her blunder by saying, "That's what I meant, dear. Just wearing such a fabulous set of jewels will make Lucy feel like a star, I'm sure." Sylvia sniffed. "I ought to be wearing them myself, but my lawyer insists it would be a dangerous thing to do." I glanced at Gran and both our eyes widened. I couldn't imagine a worse idea than Sylvia showing up when she had supposedly been dead for decades. That was the thing. If she'd been undead for centuries, she'd get away with it. But she didn't look that different from the silent screen star she had been. Wandering around the streets of Oxford, she could pass for anyone. But in the company of people who were remaking her most famous movie, there might be some seriously raised eyebrows. And that kind of scrutiny was what the local vampires always tried to avoid. Fortunately, Sylvia knew that wearing the jewels herself was impossible. As though to take her mind off the disappointment, Gran pulled out a paper bag with the Cardinal Woolsey logo stamped on it and said, "I've had the most wonderful idea. I saw the new Teddy Lamont magazine with this darling sweater knit in a diamond stitch, and he's got a whole range of jewel-colored wools. I'm making it in red in exactly your size, Lucy." I loved it when the vampires knitted me sweaters. Even though I had a wardrobe full of them, it was always nice to have something new to wear around the shop. Naturally, since Gran knitted at supersonic speed, she already had the back done and part of one sleeve. At her pace, I'd be wearing the garment tomorrow. "My idea is to make one in every color. What do you think, dear? We could display them on the back wall of the shop." I was very enthusiastic about the idea. It would really draw people in. Gran, that's a fantastic idea. Hester, the perennially whiny teenager, had pulled herself up into the back room as though she were dragging herself out of a coffin. She let out a huge sigh. "Nice for some. No one ever asks me if I might like to make something for the shop." We all turned to stare at her. Hester was not known for helping others. Then Gran, who was the nicest vampire in the world, said, "I'd be thrilled for you to do one, my dear. Which color do you like best?" Hester looked at the array of red and gold and green and sapphire blue and said, "Black." "What was the point?" Gran said, "It's not quite in keeping with our theme, though, is it? Do you think maybe you could try this blue color? It would look lovely with your eyes." That caught her attention. Since we had a new vampire in town, a young Spaniard named Carlos, Hester had actually been attempting to improve her appearance, and, at least when he was around, her attitude. Sadly, he wasn't here, so she'd reverted to the sulky Hester we all knew and didn't love. She snapped, "Fine," and held out her hand impatiently. Gran grew flustered. "Well, I don't have it here. I'll have to go to the front of the shop and get you everything you'll need." She glanced at me, looking apologetic. "Is that all right, Lucy?" "I don't run the Vampire Knitting Club. I only provide the venue. It doesn't matter to me if we're a little late starting." And so Gran took Hester to the shop for wool and supplies for the intricate sweaters they were going to knit. I settled down with the much less glamorous hat I was knitting. I thought if I really worked at it, I could have this finished by next week. I didn't have many finished projects that I could be proud of. I really needed to start pulling my weight in the knitting department. I only wished I enjoyed knitting more. Sometimes I indulge myself with wishing that my grandmother had run a chocolate shop for me to inherit. Or maybe a jewelry store. Thinking about jewelry reminded me that later that evening, Sylvia wanted me to go downstairs with her and try on the Cartier set. I felt distinctly nervous at the idea of wearing her jewelry. I knew she didn't want me to, and if there'd been any other option, she'd have taken it. But there wasn't. She seemed to think she was conferring a great favor on me. I felt the opposite. If anything went wrong, I didn't want a vampire as powerful as Sylvia holding a grudge. The very idea sent a shiver down my spine. I told myself nothing would happen and dug my knitting needles into the next stitch. We did our show and tell when everyone was gathered. Dr. Christopher Weaver, a dapper man who ran a private blood bank, was working on one of his endless vests. Mabel was making a sweater that looked like a bath mat. It was truly the ugliest thing I'd ever seen. Lime green, festooned with big crocheted flowers in orange and purple. Still, she worked at it cheerfully. Sylvia started when she saw the work in progress and then carefully averted her eyes as though she'd permanently damaged her eyeballs by looking at it. Gran and Hester were both working on diamond sweaters, and Hester seemed marginally more cheerful now that she felt included. Sylvia didn't work on anything. It was unlike her, which made me suspect that she was as nervous as I was. Carlos, the young-looking, gorgeous Spaniard, arrived with a black backpack that contained his knitting. Hester immediately transformed from sulky to sweet. "Well, I didn't think you were coming tonight," she said.
"I wasn't planning to, but I got in a tangle and I needed help."
He sat beside her and pulled out something I could have made. It wasn't tangled. His tension was too tight. I'd had the same problem when I first began knitting. I felt very pleased with myself that I could both diagnose his problem and know that I had learned to loosen up with my knitting. Progress. Since he was the only other non-expert knitter in the club, I brightened up almost as much as Hester did when he came to our meetings. She leaned in to help.
"Oh, silly, you've been knitting so tightly that you can barely get your needles in the wool. And you've dropped a stitch. Let's get you back on track."
Rafe arrived about 5 minutes later. I knew he was there when Nyx, my black familiar, perked up and let out a happy meow. I have pretty good hearing, but hers is extraordinary, especially when Rafe is around. He came in and apologized for being late. He glanced around the room almost as though checking who was there, and his gaze rested on me, and he gave me the smile that he never gives to anyone else.
"Lucy, good evening."
"Hi," I said, and then I put my head down and got back to my knitting. Okay, it wasn't exactly sweet nothings, but there were a dozen very nosy vampires overhearing our every word. Rafe had proposed to me, and I had no idea how to answer, which made everything awkward. He settled down and pulled out his own knitting. I watched him for a couple of minutes, his long-fingered hands working with fine navy cashmere. Carlos watched him too, no doubt longing for the day his knitting would be that smooth and effortless. He asked, "Is that for Lucy?" Rafe glanced up.
"I beg your pardon?"
"The sweater you're knitting, is it for Lucy?" Everyone stopped knitting and stared at him as though he'd made a bad joke. Rafe had never knit me a sweater. All the other vampires had, along with hats, scarves, mittens, leggings, dresses. But not Rafe. How had I never noticed this before?
"No," he said.
"He's afraid of the curse,"
Clara said to Mabel in a louder voice than she'd probably intended.
"Curse?" Carlos asked. "What curse?"
I'd stop knitting now, too. How could there be curses even in knitting? Was nothing safe?
"It's just a silly superstition," Gran said, but she looked like she was trying not to smile.
"Not silly at all," Clara said. "My sister Bernice had it happen to her."
"Had what happen?" I asked, dying to know what all this was about, and what it had to do with Rafe.
"The curse of the love sweater, of course," Clara said.
Carlos and I shared a glance. Curse of the love sweater.
"Bernice was set to marry her beau," Clara continued. "A nice young man. He was a stoker on the railway. She decided to knit him a sweater, lovely it was, grey with red stripes. By the time she got to the second sleeve, he was stepping out with another girl. That's a love sweater curse." She shook her head. "She put that sweater away and never picked up knitting again. Died a spinster, she did."
"The curse is foolish nonsense," Sylvia snapped, but she seemed to be in a snappish mood.
"This curse, then," Carlos asked, "does it only happen if you're already going out together?"
"No," Mabel said. "It's considered wise never to knit a sweater for someone you hope will one day be yours." Rafe had his head down and kept knitting as though he were deaf to the conversation. Since I wasn't a vampire, I could still blush and felt my face getting warm. To hide it, I got more diligent with my own knitting than was usual for me. At least I now knew why Rafe never knit me anything.
We knitted for a couple of hours, sharing gossip, and then the vampires began folding up their work. At this point, I usually went up to bed, and they went out to socialize or roam the streets, or whatever they did when most of Oxford was sleeping. Tonight, I packed away my knitting and followed Gran and Sylvia toward the trap door that led down into the tunnel toward their home. Rafe said, "Lucy, I imagined you'd be going up to bed." I wasn't going to lie to him, and Sylvia must have known it. She said, before I could open my mouth, "I want Lucy's advice about something." He raised an eyebrow and looked at her in a rather searching way, but when she didn't elaborate, he merely said, "I'll bid you all good night then," and he left. We climbed down the rough stairway into the tunnels that ran underneath the city of Oxford. For as long as I'd been coming down here, I was always still slightly creeped out when I'd climbed down the stairs. I could smell the damp from the river that had once run under here. I stuck to the side where the stone path met the rough stone wall and where torches were burning to light our way. You'd miss the doorway that leads into the vampire's lair if you didn't know it was there. They'd left it deliberately old and decrepit-looking, but looks can be deceiving. That door was as high-tech and secure as any door in the world, probably. Sylvia, Gran, and I went in, and instead of going straight through to Sylvia's rooms as I'd anticipated, we followed Sylvia's lead and sat in the living room. Most of the others were only returning to drop their work off before going out for the night. Coming into their complex was a bit like entering Aladdin's cave of wonders. The furniture was opulent, and paintings, no doubt worth a fortune, hung from the walls. Alfred, Christopher, and Theodore were headed to a poker game and soon left. Hester and Carlo sat together while she helped him knit a couple more rows, and then decreed he was doing much better and they should go for a walk and enjoy the night air. Mabel and Clara decided to watch a film in Clara's room and couldn't decide between a new movie or an old one. After several minutes of dithering, Sylvia coldly suggested that since they had all night, they had time to watch both films. They cast a glance at her and scuttled away. Finally, everyone was gone, and only then did Sylvia take me and Gran into her suite of rooms. I'd been here often enough that I no longer marveled at how much like a glamorous film set she kept her private space. After making sure her door was shut, she took down a cubist painting she'd been given back in the day. It wasn't a Picasso, it was from the School of... I got the feeling she could have had the real thing and was irked that she hadn't bought a Picasso when his paintings went for about $25. This School of guy was never going to hang in a world-famous gallery, but as a cover for a safe, it wasn't bad. Even though we were all alone, she still glanced around to double-check and then punched in some complicated security code. She opened the safe, and I held my breath. I didn't want to look, but I couldn't help myself. How often does a person get to look inside the safe of a very wealthy vampire? Chapter 2. The contents of that safe were almost as exciting as my imagination had suggested. There was a stack of gold bricks in there, some small chests, envelopes that I suspected contained stock certificates and probably deeds of property, and who knew what else. And then, from the very back, she pulled out a set of jewelry boxes. Gran and I looked at each other, and I could see my grandmother's eyes dancing with excitement. Sylvia stroked the top of the largest box the way she would a favorite pet, and then opened it, stared at the contents with a little smile, and passed it toward me. I'd expected something fabulous, but even so, I gasped. The necklace was without a doubt the most beautiful piece of jewelry I'd ever seen. Yes, I'd seen the crown jewels, and I'm not going to pretend that the Kohinoor isn't amazing, but a big, honking diamond the size of an ostrich egg in a crown has a different kind of beauty than a set of jewels designed by Cartier for an actress in the 1920s. It was never meant to denote royalty. This piece was all about glamour in a time when glamour meant something, as Sylvia would be the first to tell you. It was a necklace of diamonds and strategically placed emeralds. The large emerald was off-center, sort of the way you might tie a bow to the side. Surrounding it were a couple of baguette-cut emeralds, and the whole thing was set in a collar of diamonds that sparkled like nothing I'd ever seen before. I almost felt like I couldn't catch my breath. She seemed quite pleased at my stunned response.
Lovely, isn't it?
I cannot even begin to tell you how beautiful this is. She put that box down and opened the rest, matching earrings, bracelets for each wrist, and an emerald and diamond ring. I was overwhelmed. Also, panicked. Sylvia, I can't go out in public wearing all this stuff. I'd be terrified.
Naturally, on the night of the gala, we'll drive you in the Bentley and bring you home again afterward. During the gala, there will, of course, be tight security. You've nothing to worry about.
My eyes opened wide. You're coming too? This seemed like a very bad idea. I glanced at Gran, hoping she could talk Sylvia out of this crazy carpool, but she seemed like she was completely on board. It'll be such an adventure. Of course, we won't go to the gala, but we can watch you walk up the red carpet.
Red carpet?
Yes, at St. Peter's College. It's going to be so beautiful. St. Peter's College was one of the oldest colleges in Oxford, and that was saying something. The earliest part of the college dated back to the Middle Ages, that much I knew. I'd peeked through the gates when I'd walked by and admired the ancient spire and the gorgeous gardens. Now I was going to enter the gates in a Bentley and walk into the college on a red carpet. I felt like I was sinking deeper and deeper in quicksand. How big is this shindig? Sylvia looked pained, those famous eyes half closed as though the very sight of me was painful to her. The press and dignitaries, as well as influential movie people, have been invited. I'm not sure I can hang around with a bunch of famous rich people and pretend to be your heir. I'm not an actress. She stiffened. You are my heir, although how you could be when you have so little sense of style is completely beyond me. You will go to the meeting where you will sign the contracts that I will naturally have looked over first. Then you'll wear the jewels at the gala.
What if I trip or something? I asked in a nervous voice. I was more the jeans and sweater type.
She looked me up and down, and I knew she was thinking I was the jeans and sweater type too. We've a little time we must practice. I didn't like the sound of this.
Practice what?
Lucy, if you're going to wear these jewels, you will wear them properly.
Now,
she reached out and tilted my chin up. You've quite a nice neck. Not, of course, as lovely as mine, which was once likened to the stem of a lily, but acceptable if you hold your head up properly. Also, the shoulders, the spine must be lovely and straight. What you really need is a full training in the Alexander technique, but there isn't time.
The Alexander technique. I'd heard of it, but thought it was a style of acting, like the Stanislavski method.
Yes, the Alexander technique is a full regimen that teaches movement and breath work. It was essential to my acting success. The training might help you to stand and move with more grace. She was killing me with the compliments. She studied me. You'll wear a simple gown, black, of course, to emphasize the jewels. Your hair won't be exactly the way I wore it when I filmed the professor's wife. You haven't the bone structure. But I have an idea. And it was very clear that I wasn't going to have any say in my own appearance for this gala. The dressmaker is working on your evening gown now. Your role is quite simple. You will pose, you will smile, you will make sure the jewels are shown off to perfection. You will mingle and say the words I will script for you. And then you will slip away. Before I could stop her, Sylvia took the beautiful necklace out of the box and placed it around my neck. I could see in her eyes that she didn't want to do it, and she could no doubt see in my eyes that I didn't want her to do it. This was her necklace, her fame, and her career, not mine. The necklace felt cool and heavy and foreign around my neck. The earrings hung heavily from my lobes, and when she clasped the two bracelets around my wrists, they felt like shackles. She slipped the ring on last and made a face when she saw the state of my nails. To Gran, she said, make a note that she'll need a manicure. Gran nodded and did as she was bid. I didn't like that the undead movie star was turning my grandmother into a personal secretary, but Gran seemed so thrilled that I didn't say anything. I would have loved to take just one glimpse of what I look like in a mirror, but of course, down here, there were no mirrors. It would be pointless. Soon enough, I'd be able to see what the set looked like on me. No doubt there'd be plenty of photographs snapped at this gala. My mind shied away from that idea. Sylvia also seemed to be thinking ahead to when I'd be the human mannequin whose only purpose was to display these jewels to advantage. She said in a commanding tone, "Now, remember what I said." She put her hand on top of my head and plucked at a lock of hair. "There is a rope attached to the top of your head, and it is pulling you gently upward." I felt it, too, like I was a human puppet, and I knew who was pulling the strings. Still, I did as she told me and stood straighter. "And the shoulders back," she said, "and the hips slightly forward." This was like some weird game where you impersonated a robot. That's how I felt, jerking back and forth. I felt extremely uncomfortable, but she nodded. "And now we walk." I barely prevented myself from rolling my eyes. I was tired, it was after midnight, and I already knew how to walk. However, I had learned with Sylvia that it was easier and quicker to do her bidding. Obligingly, I walked across the living space and back again. "What?" I asked, seeing her expression. "It pains me. It absolutely pains me to watch young women walk these days. Are you hiking a mountain? Are you an explorer in the Arctic on snowshoes?" I didn't answer her, because these were obviously rhetorical questions, and not the most polite ones at that. She waved her hand, bending only at the wrist as though she were conducting a ballet. "Light on the feet, we don't march, we glide." And then she demonstrated. She looked magnificent. There was no doubt about it. She walked like a runway model or a movie star. But I wasn't a movie star, and I had no pretense to be one. I was an American woman who sold wool for a living and wore hand-knit sweaters. I was struggling enough to knit, never mind glide. But she pierced me with a steely gaze. "Now do what I just did." Oh, yeah, that was going to happen. I did my best. I imagined this rope was pulling me up. I pushed my shoulders back, my hips forward, took a few jerky steps, and nearly fell over. She shook her head. To Gran, she said, "What is this passion among young women to wear boots and trousers and go about looking like men?" "Times change, Sylvia," Gran reminded her gently, "and fashion changes with them. Not always for the better." I might not be an expert in fashion history, but I'd take my men's clothes any day over corsets and girdles. However, I wisely kept my mouth shut. "Never mind, when you get up to your apartment, you must practice on your high heels." Of course, this torture could only get worse. I couldn't manage to walk across the room looking like her in my comfortable boots. How on earth could I manage in high heels? Besides, I didn't actually own any. I had some low-heeled pumps, that was it. Somehow, I didn't think my pumps would suit Sylvia's plan to turn me into a pale version of her for one night. "I have to be honest, Sylvia, I don't think I can pull this off." Her eyes were cold and very hard. That emerald had nothing on her. "You will do it because you promised me you would, and I am relying on you." I bit my lip. I remembered all the nice things she'd done for me, all the beautiful sweaters she'd knitted, and all the time she'd done my hair and lent me jewelry, not the priceless stuff, though, and I weakened. I knew this film remake meant the world to her. "Okay, but please don't expect miracles. I'll never be you, Sylvia." She laughed softly. "Naturally, but one must do one's best." As I went back upstairs, I wondered how I'd ever been talked into this mess. And why did I have this terrible feeling in the pit of my stomach that something was going to go wrong? Chapter 3.
"What on earth are you doing?"
a cool, critical voice demanded. I nearly jumped out of my skin. I hadn't heard the bell ring. That wonderful warning bell that told me someone was entering my shop. I thought I was all alone with the walls and patterns. I've been practicing walking, and of all the people to catch me at it, looking like I was rehearsing for some Milan runway show, did it have to be Margaret Twig? Margaret was a witch who was my sometime mentor and always sarcastic and rude about it. I wasn't about to tell her about Sylvia and the gala, so I said, I got bored. It was something I saw on YouTube. Her piercing blue eyes lit with sarcastic humor. Have we been watching weddings? Practicing that glide down the aisle, were you? It was better she thought that than the truth. Something like that. Her lips curved in a superior smile. Her corkscrewed gray hair jumped up and down as though it was laughing at me. It's usually advisable to have a groom lined up before practicing that walk down the aisle. Oh, ha ha ha. Little did she know I could have a wedding with a pretty amazing groom if I wanted one. The trouble was that marriage with the undead came with a whole set of problems that were a lot more sticky than what to do when you got two identical blenders as wedding presents and didn't want either of them. Can I help you with something? I asked her. I doubted she was here for knitting needles. I'm glad you're alone, she said, which immediately made me wish I wasn't. If there was something Margaret Twig had to tell me that no one else could hear, it was probably something I didn't want to know about. She came closer and dropped her voice. Oh, this was really making me nervous. It's time for you to choose your athame. When I looked at her blankly, she added, Your ceremonial dagger. I could feel the expression of horror pull my facial muscles into some sort of grotesque mask. My what? Oh, come on, she snapped. You can't be that clueless. And then she looked at me. Well, actually, you can. But I wish you'd try a little harder, Lucy. The athame is an important part of your training. The word dagger was flashing on and off in my head like a neon sign. I shook my head. I'm a pacifist. My body is a no-weapon zone. She regarded me from her sharp blue eyes as though I was being a tedious toddler. An athame is not a weapon. It's symbolic, metaphoric, if you like. The athame cuts away lies and reveals the truth. It helps you focus your power and your magic.
Okay. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.